And brother, I praise God that he has supernaturally preserved his word. This is not just any old book we have before us. This is the book. It's not a book. It's the book. It's the word of God, and we ought to love it. We ought to cherish it. We ought to defend it. We ought to stand up for it. Of course, I like what Charles Spurgeon said years ago. Somebody came to him when he was cutting pretty close here, and they said, "Why don't you defend the Bible?" He said, "Defend the Bible? You don't have to defend it." He said, "I'd rather defend a mountain lion." He said, "Turn the Bible loose. It'll defend itself." And that's true. So we thank God that Dr. Smith's here. We're in for some great services. I can't hardly wait. I'm wanting to preach, and I'm not even going to get to. I can't hardly wait for him to come up here and teach us about the historical documentation that our Bible is rooted and grounded upon, and I'm glad you're here. In 5 minutes, we're going to be beginning the 11 o'clock service. If you've got to go to the restroom or just stand up, let's be back in here in 5 minutes. You don't want to miss a single thing. Let's keep the service going. George Gallup recently said that the Christian community, that the believers in America today are about 3,000 miles wide and 3 inches deep. I think that's a tremendous statement. He interviewed 10,000 clergymen of various denominations. One of the questions he asked them was this: do you believe that the scriptures are the inspired and inerrant word of God? Here's the results. 95% of the Episcopalians said, "We don't believe the Bible is the inspired word of God." 95% of the Episcopalian preachers that stand in the pulpit says, "We do not believe the Bible is the word of God." 87% of the United Methodist preachers said, "We do not believe the Bible is the word of God." 82% of American Baptists said, "We do not believe the Bible is the word of God." 77% of the American Lutherans said, "No, we don't believe the Bible is the word of God." Now, folks, we're in a serious, critical time in our country. If we don't have a Bible, then let's close up shop and go home, because we're spinning our wheels. But if we do have a Bible, then we better pay attention to it, because Jesus said, "By these words you shall be judged." So we cannot idly set it aside and say, "But I don't know." God has not only given us by divine inspiration his word, but has supernaturally preserved it through the years, even until this very hour, in the King James Version of the Word of God. Now, we're delighted to have with us a contender for the faith, Dr. Jules Smith. He has given himself, his life, he has dedicated himself, he has traveled extensively, as you can see before us today, to bring to us, I believe, one of the greatest truths of this hour. And that is, we still have the preserved, inspired Word of God before us. And I'm glad to have him today, and I'm honored that he'll be with us tonight at 7, tomorrow night through Wednesday night at 7 o'clock. For no other reason, the display would be worth the drive just to come to see what he's got on display here. Now, I'm going to tell you, he's a tremendous speaker. God has greatly used him and continues to greatly use him. Let's welcome him as he comes today to speak to us at this time.
Thank you so much. My subject today is the Bibles of the Martyrs. These ancient Bibles come out of the time called the Times of the Great Persecution, when literally thousands of Christians gave their lives for the Word of God and for the testimony of the Lord Jesus. During that time, to be caught with a Tyndale Bible in your hand, like the one I hold in my hand, could well mean your death. Two famous preachers of this period of time, William Woosley and Robert Pigott, were caught preaching on the street out of a Tyndale Bible, like the one that I hold before you. They were arrested, brought into court, And there in court, before the judge read the sentence, his last question to Pastor Woosley was, "Will you give me some idea of your belief on the Bible?" Pastor Woosley said, "I take the eternal God to my record that I do err no point or part of God's word, the Holy Bible, but hold and believe the same to be the most firm, sound doctrine in all points, most worthy of my salvation and for all who will believe." The infuriated judge said, "Pastor Woosley and Pastor Piggott, I sentence you to be burned at the stake immediately with the slow burning." These two preachers, hearing their sentence read, they knelt in prayer in court, prayed for the judge that had just read their sentence. They prayed for God to give them grace to die as a Christian dies, got up off their knees, and told and walked to the stake, singing the Psalms as joyfully as if they were going to a wedding instead of their deaths, or even to a banquet. They were praising God. They were chained to the stake about the waist, and the fires were set. It was a slow burning. In the fast burning, they used straw, brittle material, poured an oil on it. When the torch was set, the flames came up quickly. But in the slow burning, they used a greener substance all about the stake that would first slowly crawl up the bare legs, burning the outer layers of skins as the body fluids fell in the fire. That's the way they burned these two preachers. But when the fire reached their bare feet, the substance was so green, it looked like the fire would rise no higher. And one of the religious leaders said, "Bring those 10-day-old Bibles we've confiscated. We'll feed the fire with their own Bibles." And two servants brought a sheet filled with 10-day-old Bibles. They began to tear them up and throw them on the fire. And Pastor Woosley said, "Give me one of them." And while the fire burned their feet and their legs, Pastor Woosley turned to the Gospel of John and read the Word of God to the people gathered there. And the people suddenly came under a holy conviction. And even the people cried out, "Lord, help these men." They believed that at least one-third of the people that gathered there were converted to Christ while the martyr read the Word of God. And as the fire came on up, they held the Bibles near their bosom while the fire did its work. And they dropped their heads in death, but they lifted them in eternal life in the presence of Him who is life. And Jesus said, "Be thou faithful unto death, and I'll give unto thee a crown of life." And the Bible says they loved not their lives unto the death. In the times of the great persecution were raging. That's recorded in Hebrews 11:35-38. Please turn to the text scripture, Hebrews 11:35-38. And then I'll ask you to please stand for the reading of the text scripture. Notice at the latter part of verse 35, please stand for the reading of the text scripture. Notice verse 35, "And others were tortured, not accepting deliverance, that they might obtain a better resurrection. And others had trial of cruel mockings and scourgings, yea, moreover, bonds and imprisonment. They were stoned, they were sawn asunder, were tempted, were slain with the sword. They wandered about in sheepskins and goatskins, being destitute, afflicted, tormented, of whom the world was not worthy. They wandered in deserts, in mountains, and in dens and caves of the earth." This describes how that our people suffered for the Word of God and for the testimony of Jesus. But Paul tells us in Philippians 1:29, "For unto you it is given in the behalf of Christ, not only to believe on Him, but also to suffer for His sake." Nobody's been set free from responsibility. Not only to believe on Him, but also to suffer for His sake. Father, we thank Thee for these courageous preachers, William Woosley and Robert Piggott. Though they were tortured, they would not submit or compromise. God, I pray You'll bless the message. I pray that Christians will be built up and edified in the most holy faith. I pray for those that sit in darkness. May the light of the glorious gospel of Christ shine into that poor soul. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. You may be seated. Notice our text scripture. I want to comment on a couple of things. He says, and others were tortured, not accepting deliverance. They were always offered deliverance. But if they had accepted deliverance, they had to deny some point or some part of the Word of God. And when they asked these courageous preachers, William Woosley and Robert Pigott, if you'll only deny this, we'll set you free. They said, no, we cannot deny anything. We will die before we'll deny. Then notice another statement that's misunderstood or unknown among Bible believers today. Verse 37, they were sawn asunder. Sawn asunder, that takes us back to the time when the state church, who had the political power, would deem people to be heretics, and they would sentence them to be executed, and they wanted to make money off that execution. In fact, they still like to make money off of everything they do. And so when they announced that they were going to kill these people on certain days, they would announce a carnival, and people would come in from the countryside, and they'd live in tents, and they'd tent out for 3 or 4 days. There would be drunkenness, gambling, cursing, blaspheming God, even adultery. And at the end of that 3 or 4 day carnival is when they would kill the Christians. They would burn some of them at the stake. Others would be taken, and they would be tied, their hands and feet together. And then they'd place them in a board box, nail the board box shut, and 2 men take the crosscut saw and saw it in two with the Christian inside. Could you imagine an 11-year-old girl, and they kill children this way too, being placed in a board box, and as the teeth of the saw cut through the wood and the tearing of the flesh, what a horrible thing that would be. They were sawn asunder. Our people suffered for the Word of God and for the testimony of Jesus. Then I want you to notice another thing. They wandered about in sheepskins and goatskins, being destitute, afflicted, tormented, of whom the world was not worthy. They wandered in deserts and in mountains and in dens and caves of the earth. They would take our people and they'd hold their hands down by their sides. They'd wrap goat skins or animal skins around the Christian, sewing the skins together. And those skins were wet, turn them out under the hot sun. It began to dry the animal skins out. But every farmer knows that wet animal skins will stretch, but as they dry out, they'll shrink, causing a suffocation, a slow agonizing death. And the people were warned in the countryside, you're not to give food or water to the Christian or system in any way. And they'd wander for days, living in dens and caves and mountains, a little family, mom and dad and 3 children sewn in animal skins, slowly starving while the animal skins drew tighter and tighter until death came. The Bible says, of whom this world was not worthy, our people suffered for the Word of God and for the testimony of Jesus. But Paul said, it is given unto you in the behalf of Christ, not only to believe on Him, but also to suffer for His sake. God has